All right, this time I'll call this meeting to order. To be advised, school board trustees and all members present except for Mr. Murphy, Superintendent Mr. Boggs, Assistant Superintendent Mr. Conley, Returning Secretary Mrs. McFarland, and our student representatives. Upcoming board meetings on December the 12th, 2016, regular meeting at Midtown Elementary at 6:30 p.m. On January the 16th, 2017, regular meeting will be at the Burkett Educational Center at 6:30 p.m. And on February the 13th, 2017, regular meeting at the Tippecanoe Valley Middle School at 6:30 p.m. And at this time, I'll turn it over to Mr. Boggs on the spotlight on the valley.
Okay, thank you, Dave. We'd like to welcome any of our new employees that are being approved on the board tonight. I see one here, Mr. Leedy's here. Eric, would you like to maybe introduce yourself to the board, tell us a little bit about who you are?
My name is Aaron Leedy, and I was recently hired to take Cassie's place as the Director of Public Relations and Grant Writing and Marketing. I grew up around here. I'm a North Miami grad, grew up in Miami County, come from a farming family background, and my most recent role was in Huntsville, Alabama, as a TV news anchor and a producer, and it was in that industry that I kind of hopped around a little bit within broadcasting. So this was a great opportunity to return closer to my family and kind of still use the same skills that I gained when I was in college and also throughout my journalism career. So I thank you guys for the opportunity, and things have been going well so far. Cassie has made the transition very smooth. She's always available on a phone call or an email, and we've got a lot of good things coming up and a lot of things that we're working on right now, so I'm very happy to be here. Thank you.
You're welcome, Lord. Okay.
Want to move on then?
Yeah.
Next one? Okay. We would like to honor the Tippecanoe Valley Middle School Spell Bowl team tonight. To do that, I'll turn it over to Mr. Backus.
All right, if I can have see Ross and the kids that showed up, just kind of stand over here to the side. I'll read off some of their accomplishments here. So this year, the Spell Bowl team made its fourth trip to the IASB State Finals Spell Bowl. To do that, you have to qualify in the top groups in your class in the state. We were class three this year. I've been in class two in previous years, which is some bigger schools. This year we bumped down one group. Our regional event this year was hosted at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School. There were 10 teams total from our area, including Little Warsaw School, Wall City, Jimtown, some schools from Elkhart. So a lot of big schools there, and our kids actually had the highest point total of the 10 teams there, even though they were from all four classes. And then when we got the results the next day, we actually had the top score in the state in class three headed into the state finals with 45 out of 72 correct words, I believe, is what we scored in the regional. And then just this past Saturday afternoon in Lafayette was the state finals at Purdue University, and we finished in fourth place in the state finals, which is tied for the best finish our school has ever had in this activity. So want to recognize the entire team, especially those that showed up today. So the good news is we only have 3 8th graders in the group. So of the 10 kids that participated in total, 7 will be coming back next year potentially to spell again. So our 8th graders were Devin Chandler and Mateo Salazar.
I'm not. He's a 7th. Yeah, we only had 2.
You are 7th. So I really went on the wrong list. So we had 8 coming back. Should I say that it seems like I've had you longer than that? But no, Mateo did an awesome job. And then Riley Bullinger was actually one of our alternates, but due to another student having to go to an out-of-state activity over the weekend, he joined in, was our first speller this weekend. So, sorry, eighth grader, seventh grade then, Mateo. And then Mallory Bowers, who was not able, she participated in the regional, was not able to participate in the state. And then Brady Shepherd was an alternate for us as well. Sixth grade, we had Abby Bowers.
I forgot to change tenders.
This is what happens when you're running down the curtain and walk in the door. Chaney was a seventh grader as well, and she spelled in both regional and state finals. Abby Bowers, Kennedy Kohler, who was here, Emily McGriff, who was here, and Patrick E.C., were our sixth graders. And then Coach Suzanne Seabrocks, how many years have you done this now?
Maybe 10.
10, okay. And you guys actually won the Running Rivers Conference this year as well, which is 7 of the last 8, I believe, is what we figured, that we won the Running Rivers Conference. And then also recognize Lynn Randall, who's been our proctor. So we have to take an adult along who monitors the table for another team at every event. So these kids put a ton of time in. The list of words is crazy. I think Mr. Connolly and I sat together Saturday, and of the 72 words, got about 8 of them figured out by the time. The timer went off, and he said,
"That's a high guess."
So,
they might each say their favorite word.
Absolutely.
Okay. Mateo, what's your favorite word? Most difficult word?
Any of them?
Okay, excellent. Acetylsalicylic acid?
And like, did you have a most difficult word that you like?
I think Thatcher's was like two-edged sword.
Okay, your favorite word?
Either just Pepsi or milk free. Milk free,
whatever that one is. I don't know.
Now was that the one we got the fist pump from Saturday? Because it was the last word. Yeah, this is, it's a really awesome accomplishment for these kids. They put a lot of time in, they work really hard during the school year, and for them to not only beat a lot of the larger schools in our area on an annual basis, but to also be at the state level through the last 4 years is pretty outstanding. And with the number of kids we've got coming back, there's a great opportunity for them to do it again the next couple of years. So definitely appreciate the time and the effort they put in. It was exciting to get to go watch.
Diphtheria. That's
Saturday. Ben, we're really proud of you. We hear a lot about athletic accomplishments. Great academic accomplishments. Those are wonderful things. So
made the school proud.
That's good job.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Seabrocks.
Appreciate it, guys.
Chaney, you're on my list.
You're just on the
Thanks, guys. And this being the first year of the 1-1 project at middle school, now we're well on our way. We thought it might be nice to have Mr. Max come in and get an update on this.
I put together just a one-page printout here. It's got some information on the implementation. It's got some teacher feedback that I asked teachers to provide for me. I put a few things on there for me and then some concerns going forward. So I'm not going to read the whole thing, but just want to hit some of the highlights. On the implementation side, all teachers were able to receive their training in July on the new devices, and then we're allowed to take them home for the duration of the summer. And then our teacher work day Friday, we were able to spend the bulk of that day training with STI chalkable people and working in groups on getting a good handle on that technology and how we were going to use it. Really excited and happy with the tech department that 100% of the students had their devices by Wednesday of week one. So we were off and running with every kid having a device, using it in classes by day three, functionally. And then Mr. Cavender has been fantastic. He's great to work with from the administrative side, but he's a very hard worker as well, troubleshooting and making sure that everybody's able to be up and running as much as possible. So Some kudos to Matt, art tech at the middle school, for really working hard and being a great employee for us to work with. Teacher feedback, just a couple highlights. The technology has been easy to incorporate in the classroom. The ability to take writing through the stages of the writing process has been much more worthwhile with the device, because revisions involve going in and fixing a digital copy of work, not rewriting the paper every time they're revising it. So it's saving us time, but it's also giving more test-like scenario, because they're going to be doing these things on the I-step where they have to actually write out the writing prompt on the computer down the road. It's allowing greater depth and completeness. Plus, we're gaining valuable practice on keyboarding and creating documents. From the math side, we can always fill every minute of a period now in math because of the students having Alex and the ability to use that on the computer. They're learning to be digital citizens and understanding how to look for reliable sources on the internet. We have instant access to grades and missing assignments. There's real-world authentic learning going on. Students are becoming more computer literate, and it's allowing for differentiation. So those are just some quick highlights from the teachers. There's tons more things that they said that obviously couldn't fit on one sheet of paper. For me, the ability to access learning opportunities in the classroom is much greater now. We've seen very few Wi-Fi connection issues. The issues we've seen were from one failed router that was fixed and replaced, and we don't have any more issues with that now. So all of our kids are able to get on the computers in our building without any lagging of speed, without any connectivity issues. The infrastructure was solidly constructed to make all this work ahead of time, and it's a credit to the tech staff, Mr. Cooper, and the teachers in our building for really putting the time and effort into making all those things work. I feel like in our building, the teachers are really embracing the devices. They're being used in most classes on a daily basis, and teachers are incorporating that technology as a tool, but not just turning kids loose to just play on their computers all period. We continue to look for and implement professional development that's helping our teachers use the devices more effectively. And right now, they're a really great resource for each other, and the ability to share what's working and not working in our collaboration discussions. So the teachers are really doing a good job of teaching each other things. They're learning all the devices as we're going through the school year. We're going to run an I-STEP trial here coming up the week after Thanksgiving, when we take Acuity. Acuity is our formative assessment, and so we're actually going to run a mock I-STEP session where we run a two-hour delay schedule. All the kids take Acuity at the same time. All of the kids will be on, connected, in their testing rooms, A, to make sure that we have connectivity enough to handle all the tests, but also to make sure that we have a good plan in place when I-STEP rolls around, so that we can get the testing in a week this year, rather than the 3.5 to 4 weeks it's taken us with only two computer labs in the past. So we're hoping we're going to gain a lot of instructional time back now that we have the computers. So concerns today, the biggest concern has been Chockable. Okay, Chockable is the student management teacher classroom design platform that we use that's tied to STI. It's Chockable itself, this is the first year for that product, and it's sort of in a beta test period, and it feels like we're the ones being used for the beta test, and the stuff they're telling us is supposed to work has not been working. And it's been very disappointing. We've dumped a lot of training and effort and time into this particular software, and it's failing to do the stuff that we needed to do, like allowing teachers to open and edit documents and send them back to kids, to communicate with kids. And so Keith has been working with Chockable to try to remedy the problems. The other thing that we had come up about 2 weeks ago is Chockable got bought out by PowerSchool. So what we don't know is what that's going to look like down the road now. But what I've seen in my building is teachers sort of just push it to the side and move on to other pieces of online technology that they can use and be functional, because it's been a very frustrating piece. So since the beginning of the school year, we've had 29 device damage and failure issues. Most of those are cracked screens. And what we found is that those were happening in specific areas more than others, and it was more so due to storage issues in the classroom than it was students mishandling them. And so we've tried to rectify that by getting shelving units and things into classrooms so that we're getting them up off the floor or off of seats and tables when kids aren't using them, so they're not in places where they can be stepped on or knocked off a table or dropped. And so from the standpoint of having things intentionally broken and damaged, we've had one incident where a couple of kids ran into each other in the hallway and sort of started pushing and shoving each other, and one of their devices hit the floor and broke. Other than that, it's been unintentional things during passing periods or pieces like that. So, you know, we figure we've got 440 kids moving eight times a day, and I think I figured roughly that's 3,520 opportunities for damage on a daily basis, let alone the number of days we're in school. So we're looking for ways to keep this list as low as possible, but I think in the whole scope of things, we've done a really good job so far, and the kids are doing a really good job of doing the best they can to take care of the devices.
Are those things that we can fix too?
You know, we've had those conversations and haven't really been able to pin that down because there's going to be some training involved for the company. The biggest issue is because we have the warranty that we purchased with these devices. The concern is that our techs fixing them in-house avoids warranty issues. So right now we've simply been following the warranty expectations, sending them out to get fixed and getting them back.
To turn around good.
Yeah. It's not been bad, it's been within a week, and right now we purchased enough extras, we're able to hand out over to kids so we don't have kids that are out of service, so to speak. We've had a couple that were repeats, and so they did have fees charged for repeat damage, but overall most of the issues have been taken care of through the warranty that we were able to purchase when we bought the devices. So that's been a good thing. Through the Title I grant, we were able to purchase some software called Power of ICU, and actually that is a list for missing homework assignments that we're able to have all the teachers access. And when a student's name is put on that list, parents are automatically texted and emailed that their child is put on the list, and then they're also notified when they're taken off. So it's a quick communication piece for us, but it's also a centralized location where we can keep track of the kids that are behind. We have Catch-Up Cafe in place, which is where our kids go during lunch if they have missing work. So this is sort of our organizational piece for that, but it's also a communication piece that's allowing parents to be contacted. And then we've purchased through the actual one-on-one program that you guys approved, we purchased monitoring software through Insight, and this actually allows the teachers to pull up all the screens of all the kids in their classroom. They have access to go in and shut a student's computer off if they're not following instructions. They can limit websites. They can message kids directly on their screen. If I'm the teacher, I can actually project my screen on all the kids' devices, or I can select the kid's device and project it on all the screens to show samples of things in the classroom. So it's a pretty neat technology. It was just purchased about a month ago, and I believe all of the student devices now have it logged on, and we have it in three or four classrooms at this point. We're working to get that expanded, but our goal is by Christmas to have that on every teacher's computer so that they have access to monitor what the kids are doing and limit access to getting anywhere inappropriate. So we've had some issues obviously with kids trying to play games and stuff like that. So this is the next step for us to try to just make sure that we're monitoring what they're doing and what they're on and keeping them tied into what's going on in the classroom. So overall, I don't know that I could ask for it to have come off much better than it's done with sort of the short turnaround we had with it. Like I said, the biggest disappointment right now has been the chalkable software, and that's something beyond our control. So, questions?
Yep, sounds good.
Sounds good.
Thanks.
Yep.
A couple of upcoming events that are going to be sponsored by the Typically Valid Community Mental Health Task Force tomorrow evening here at Mentone, 4:15 to 5:15. We will sponsor a training session on QPR, suicide prevention. It is primarily for new staff members. We have all of our staff members train each year. We train new staff members, and so that training is for them. But if anybody from the community, from the public, would like to attend that training, it's open to them as well. So tomorrow at 4:15 here at Mentone, Hunter Randall, he's the professional trainer for the Bowling Center. Hunter will do the training for us and does a good job. And then this Saturday, November the 19th, from 9:30 to noon, we're going to hold a regional event at the middle school. It's for a 7-county region here in northern Indiana. It's called International Survivors of Suicide Loss Day. It was something that we were encouraged to do, and Mrs. Seabross volunteered to head that up for us. It's an opportunity for folks that are survivors of suicide, who have known someone that took their life, to get together, to talk and heal. And there's my understanding, a movie that we'll watch that is a new creation by the organization that puts this on. I think it'll be an interesting, beneficial day. So if you know somebody that's dealt with suicide or you have yourself, we invite you to join us for that.
That's it. All right, at this time we'll move to item C, items from visitors. Do we have any items from the visitors? Hearing none, we'll move to the consent agenda. Item one, approve the minutes of the October 10, 2016 regular meeting and executive session. Item two, approve the hiring of the following personnel: Aaron Leedy, Director of Marketing, Public Relations, and Grant Writing at Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation. Nicole McNeely, Instructional Assistant at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School. Caleb Prater, Instructional Assistant at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School. Kelly Hart, Cook at Tippecanoe Valley High School. And Brandon Oswald, Custodian at Tippecanoe Valley High School. Item three, approve the following extracurricular assignments: Kyle Brown, Varsity Assistant Football Coach at Tippecanoe Valley High School. And Chris Fuller, 7th grade girls basketball coach at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School. Item four, accept the resignation of the following personnel: Cassandra Jensen, Director of Marketing, Public Relations, and Grant Writing at Tippecanoe Valley School Corporation. Irish Johnston, Custodian at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School. Jack Stamball, the boys tennis coach at Tippecanoe Valley High School. And Kelsey Miller, Cook at Tippecanoe Valley High School. Approve the maternity leave request for the following personnel: Haley Whitaker, kindergarten teacher at Akron Elementary, and April Stiles, family and consumer science teacher at Tippecanoe Valley Middle School. Approve the overnight trip for the Tippecanoe Valley High School girls varsity basketball team, and approve the senior out-of-state trip. Is there anything the board would like to pull out?
Nope.
Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
I'll make that motion.
Todd makes a motion to approve the consent agenda. Is there a second?
No second.
Tom seconds. All in favor of approving the consent agenda as read, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Move to approval of claims and payroll.
Okay. We have one pre-registered claim listing this evening. It's dated October 31, 2016, in the amount of $697,100.48. Our regular claim listing is dated November 14, 2016, in the amount of $134,826.79. We have two payrolls this evening. The first is dated October 14, 2016, in the amount of $443,254.70. The second is dated October 28, 2016, in the amount of $415,949.23. I submit these claims and payroll for your approval.
Is there any questions on the claims and payroll? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the claims and payroll? Stan makes that motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Todd makes a second. All in favor of approving the claims and payrolls as read, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Financial report.
Okay. You have before you the reconciled bank statement and monthly financial report of funds for the month of October 2016. Summary, our receipts and disbursements for the month of October are total receipts for all funds, $1,609,771.90. Our total disbursements for all funds, $1,666,073.62.
Any questions?
No.
Hearing none, we'll go to old business. Update on the Akron Elementary School project.
I believe that Mr. Fennerling from the Skilling Corporation is here tonight to give us an update. So what's going on at Akron, Jim?
The work in progress will start there last month. We continued with the unit D&B CMU walls. And we started roofing over the gym. Actually, today we completed the 4 inches of insulation and on the roof of the gym. It's in the dry now. They're doing some detailing around the parapet walls. And you'll probably be able to see some of those pictures there. How old is that, Mr. Bob? Is that several weeks?
November 14. Well, those were probably taken last week.
Last week?
Oh, yes. That's looking over the elevator.
Mm-hmm. You can see the material on the roof there in places.
That's the gym.
There's the gym right there. That's the, all the storm drains are in, and of course they're all connected to the roof drains and the overflows, and like I say, it's in the dry there.
What kind of ceiling will be in there, or in the gym? What kind of a ceiling?
That is just a standard metal deck, but there is the insulating soundproof panels that actually go on the bottom of the deck. It's something new that I haven't used, but something new they've come up with. It's panels that are 4 foot wide and they go between the bar joists, so it should help deaden the sound in there. So
you won't see the trusses?
It's between the trusses right on the deck.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you'll still see the trusses.
Trusses will be painted. They'll be painted though, won't they?
Yeah. I think there'll be a colored, I don't know if for white or not. I haven't gone through the colors for it, but.
Black, I
think. Are they?
I think black.
Are they black?
I think so. That's what Adam said.
That could be, yeah. We've completed the metal decking for Unit D. That's the one that's the area that is to the north. And today they are putting insulation up on that, ready to start putting the insulation and rubber on that.
So they put the steel decking on it. And what's on top of the steel decking? The insulation?
Two layers of 2-inch insulation.
And then the rubber goes on top of that.
And then the rubber goes on top of that. So that's what's on all of the roof areas. 4 inches of styrofoam. We've continued metal joist in Unit B. That's kind of an ongoing thing. We, I think today, just put the joist over the kitchen area, and they'll be installing deck probably tomorrow there. And they started the exterior brick in the courtyard. Reason being, there's only one way into that, so we got to come in from the west side and try to get all the brick up before we close that off to do the Unit C area, which is the office area. So, but they are above the windows right now. They've got all the red on, and above the windows it's kind of a light color. It's yellowish color. I don't know the name of it. You happen to know it, but it's a kind of a light color, kind of matches the old building there, about that color. So, and then in mechanical, I mentioned the starting of roof drain piping. In D, that's about probably 75% this time. Tomorrow, when they start the roof insulation on there, they will be hooking up to that. There's a lot of overhead ductwork going on in Unit D. Normally we don't do that till it's totally in the dry, but they wanted to proceed. So as they're putting up this big metal duct, it's probably, a lot of it's 4 foot wide. They are putting a visqueen over the top of it. so we don't get any moisture, you know, through, because the ductwork is kind of an insulated, has a liner inside of it, and so it needs to be protected. So that's why they're putting this best clean over the top. Got the permanent power completed now. So we got some more temporary lighting inside the building. See, you're looking at clear to the north there, that is Unit D, and the old building here is to your right. Chiller and the, it's on the north side, or I'm sorry, the east side of the boiler room area, and that was delivered. So that will be, since we get a pad poured out there, we can be setting that. See, that shows up there. But if you know where the storage building is, it's just between there and the building where that goes. We got two pads there, one for a generator and one for a big chiller. There's some issues there that I can tell you about later on, Mr. Rhodes. And fire protection piping, they've got the gym pretty well done. They've continued with that, so that's moving along pretty good in Unit B area. So, and they haven't started anywhere else yet, but Unit B, the most of these fire protection piping is in. Work plan for the next 4 weeks is complete roofing. He's got over the gym, but that's about done. Complete areas of B and D slab on grade as soon as we can. Don't need to be driving through the building there. If you look right there at the top of the picture, there's kind of a dark streak there, and that's the area where they're driving through there at this time, right there, yes. And to the left of that, that is the courtyard. And we got that material out of there, that was a bunch of steel. And there's scaffolding in there now, where they're doing brickwork on the east wall and the north wall of that that area. And if you see, you know where the cafeteria is there, Mr. Bob?
Right
there. Those little square spots right above it, right there. That's a series of beams down through there. That's a column, actually. You see, and then there's beams on top of that, and then the masonry wall goes on top of those beams on up. So that makes the ceiling in the cafeteria a lot higher than the side there. So. We will be starting exterior brick in Unit D within the next 4 weeks. We'd like to get that at least up to the bottoms of the windows. You can't put windows in without the sill being in there, and really all the brick ought to be on before the windows go in. The masons all like to work around windows, block some brick and do a little damage. But we'll have to close it up and put heat inside of it. And that's framing and the visqueen or something to shut the air down on doors and all the windows. So
the plan is to go up to the windows with the brick.
Yeah.
Wait until spring to finish that up.
If we can get that far, we can at least put the window in. But the architect really don't want to put windows in until all the brick's out. But we need to close it off some way. Either with windows or temporary. So. We'll be setting the air handlers in the Unit D mezzanine area. The mezzanine floor has been poured. The equipment's setting up there. So they can, they got to pour what you call a house pad for all of those. And when they get those poured, we can set all of that equipment. They will continue with the overhead, the heating and cooling piping that's been going on daily. And they're continuing to roof in all of the electrical throughout D and B as needed. So, as far as the schedule goes, ending date is off a little bit. I think Brandon told me about 2 weeks. Masonry is off more than that, but we're getting some other work done that kind of keep ahead of things, so we keep that moving. When you drive by, it looks like it's everything's going great, but you know, we are behind on masonry. And that's masons are coming from Anderson, they're coming from Marion, they're coming from Fort Wayne and South Bend, and if I find a job closer, it's so hard to keep them there. So, any questions they have?
Are they going to, how are those two buildings, the, I don't know if it's BOD, the other schools to the north, how are those going to be joined, or are they?
Yeah. You got a courtyard between the old and the new. That picture there.
Yeah, this
right there's a courtyard right there.
Yeah, that's a courtyard you're standing.
And today we're putting beams across.
Here to here.
Right through there.
Okay.
You see those beams and bar joists laying there? We're starting to install those, and the cement trucks can drive under those beams.
Okay.
And so we can still get in there, and that's the only area we have to pour yet. Actually, that area right there is part of Unit C. It's from the, kind of joins in with Unit D, this classroom area. And then to the right, you see some walls started there. That is the office area. And they're getting some of the masonry work done there. So we need to always keep a way for
to get a way out. I get it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, entrance to the building, the office there will be right in here somewhere, won't you?
Yes. Yeah, you can see that.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can see where it kind of sets at an angle to the southwest. The just up a little bit is right there was the new entry, and that's where the new, the old limestone will be installed. In the front of that office area will be mostly a limestone panels. It's going to look pretty nice.
This building is the one that's going to get total renovation next summer.
Yeah. Yeah, that building gets new windows throughout on the outside. Yeah, a lot of interior work. So, but outside, I think mostly just windows, new windows, and
roof.
Yeah.
And that stucco too. That stucco needs some attention.
Yeah.
It'll look like a new building.
Yeah, basically. All together.
The only difference you'll see if you walk into that courtyard, the windows on the new part will have limestone. Actually, they're precast concrete panel under the windows, but the old part does not get that. So you. I questioned that the other day with the architect. And, but it gets pretty expensive to tear off. It's a soldier course where they stand the brick up under the windows. And it'd be expensive to tear all that out and put limestone in there. But so you would have a little different look in that area, but it won't be a big issue. Just look.
About financially, are we on track there? Or do you know?
I don't get into that.
Yeah,
don't tell me too much.
Yeah, I think we are.
Should be.
Okay,
We're on track. We're staying pretty close. We've got out of the Bank of New York.
Yeah, mostly good contractors.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anything else?
Thank you, Jim.
Okay, we'll move to item two, update on the farmer's report.
Okay. made some really good progress here in the past 3 weeks on our Farm to Fork initiative. If you want to hit the slideshow. Yep. Just got some pictures here of the work that's been done. We put tried to dig a trench here for water, electrical, and fiber. And I told Ty Lewis that I would make him famous by putting a picture of him in the PowerPoint here, so everybody in Rochester can give him a hard time. But you can see we've tried to reuse some material there. The piping was. It's something that we had from another project, so we were able to reuse that here. We put in the water hydrant along with the black piece of tubing there is to help that Ritchie water system. It goes down below the frost line, and so we don't have to deal with any broken water lines. There will be a you can go to the next slide, Mr. Boggs. That's kind of the finished product there. It's hard to see, but that orange flag right there in the middle, we will put a 4x4 concrete slab that will go up to the lip of that tube. So that's a project that Mr. Jones is going to be working with one of his classes on within the Ag Department. So. We're using a couple different classes with this project to get this work finished. This is Dan Peters on the left-hand side, and that is Dan's steel jig that he uses to build these structures. And Dan is a farmer on the south side of Rochester. He has a passion for agriculture. He has a 3-acre micro farm. And he also runs a business called the Scrapwood Sawmill. And I just was introduced to Dan, and we got to talking about these structures through Jeff Shriver. And he has worked with kids before and was really excited about this this opportunity. So we finally got things scheduled. And he and his brother-in-law, Jerry, came out. And the next picture is how we moved that steel jig with the bobcat. We didn't have 50 kids try to move the thing, but when we got it in place over by the maintenance shed, the next slide there, Mr. Boggs, what this allowed us to do is to square up the two corners on the left-hand side. That's the whole purpose in the steel jig with the construction of this building. Dan really talked about how this process makes it very easy to build these structures. And he really talked about our kids and spoke very positively in terms of working with them. Really enjoyed the experience with our students. The next slide, that's a group working there. Dan brought his scaffolding in to work with the students. They're measuring that out. You've got four kids up on the scaffolding there, and Dan is down doing some measuring, and one of the students is marking off some of the measurements that needed to be done. The students that worked on this were from Mr. Jones's Ag construction class, and then Mr. Franklin's intro to construction class. So we were rotating kids in and out for about 6 or 7 days to get this structure built. As you look, it's on runners there, and you see the steel pipe down in the left hand corner. We attached that pipe to our tractor, and it slid right off the jig, and we pulled it out into the area that we're going to be using, which the next picture, you see the finished product there. This This past Saturday, we had our post driven for the fencing that will be hopefully coming in this week. We're going to be using 24-foot, 14-gauge steel panels to put up and to lag onto those posts. The area is going to be 48 feet by 144 feet with a 16-foot swing gate. So it's going to be wide enough that we can get a truck in and out of there. Can you go back there, Mr. Boggs? To the right of the shelter there, we had a pole put in with a light, and we'll also be putting a security camera there and then on the building also. We really want this to be a secure location for our beloved cattle. The last slide, you know, what we've addressed so far, I talked about, and then what we're looking at doing. You know, it's going to be 68 degrees on Friday, so I'm hoping we can get the panels in and get those up this week. We talked about the concrete for the water system. We've got an old cell feeder that we're purchasing, and we have donated hay ring. And I talked about security cameras, and we're working with local people who are when we put the word out back in December, we had folks that we contacted about bringing some cattle to the property. So the other part of this, we know we're going to have reoccurring costs. And I've been working with Mr. Leedy, and he's working on some grants right now to help secure funds for those reoccurring costs. But we are getting so close, I can almost smell the manure. What questions does the board have? It's a cool project.
So you'll be your son
helped out with it.
You're going to help shovel that then, right?
Well, I'll probably get that delegated to me, so I'm on.
Taste of the steak, so. Great. It's a good deal. It's nice the Ag Department's working seriously with that.
Great.
Yeah. Mr. Jones sounds like he's done a super job.
It's been a lot of collaboration between teachers, Mr. Franklin, and he really really grabbed the bull by the horns.
Yeah.
I better stop.
Yeah. All right, is there any other old business?
That's it.
All right, we'll move to new business. Okay. Approval of donation from the Kosciuszko County Historical Society Genealogy Library.
You know, normally, if a book is donated to our school corporation, I'm not probably going to bring that to you for approval. This is kind of a unique situation. This is a really nice book called Schools of Kosciuszko County, 1835 to 1975. So it actually has Tiffany Valley High School in there as well. But it was donated to us by Kosciuszko County Historical Society, their genealogical library. And for those of you that have lived in this community for a while, you would really enjoy taking a look at this book. There's a lot of history in there that pertains to our school. So going to tomorrow give this to Andrew Michael, who's the media specialist at the high school. And this will be available at Tiffany Valley High School to the public. If somebody would like to come out, take a look at it, it'll be there. We're probably not going to check it out. But if someone would like to come, just come to the office and let them know that you'd like to take a look at the book. And we'll make sure that you get a chance to take a look at it. So I want to thank the genealogical library there at Kosciuszko County for donating this to Tiffany Valley. Very nice.
Thank you. Awesome.
We also have another donation tonight that I would like to, I guess you guys want to accept all these at the same time?
Yeah, we just got two. Yeah, that'll work.
Dr. Bennington earlier this year was a presenter at the Indiana School Safety Specialist Academy, and as part of his presentation, they presented a stipend to him. He's going to donate that to the high school to help fund their student assistance program there. So. Obviously, I'd like to thank Dr. Bendixson for that, and probably I'll have you guys go ahead and accept those, and
We have a motion to accept the donations as read.
I'll make a motion to accept the donations.
Tom makes a motion to accept the two donations. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Todd seconds. All in favor of accepting the donations, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
And then while we're talking about the student assistance program, Dr. Bennington, you want to kind of give the board an update on that tonight, so.
Thank you all for coming to meet me this evening. Just got a quick memo that I put together so you could kind of see where we're at. This was presented to you this evening because we added some things or wish to add some things to our student assistance plan. This was something that was approved last year. This largely is coordinated through the Bowen Center, where they come to the school and meet with students there. But wanted to give some background and then kind of show what we added here. And I won't read all of it, but I'll go through some of it quickly. When we look at some academic concerns at our school, many are not really academic. They may be emotional in nature. So to address those can really help us get to these other things. So just some information, just from August of this year, we've had 33 students referred to Bowen Center for some degree of counseling. 22 of those students have met with Bowen at this time. Some may be scheduled in the future. 8 of those students expressed some type of suicidal thought or ideation. 3 parents have declined. Some parents have chosen to take their children elsewhere. Most meetings do occur at the school, but not all. The plan that we helped fund will pay for 2 50-minute sessions for the students, and then after those sessions or during those sessions, Bowen will talk with the parents and see if they need to fund further sessions, and that would be done through if there's Medicaid or parent insurance. School assistance, we do have some grant money to help with that. But where we run into a problem is if the student's not on Medicaid and their private insurance doesn't cover it, that becomes a bit of an issue continuing after the 2 sessions for some people. So, but we do our best to supplement that. This is not a standalone program. We've got a number of other things that come into the student assistance plan. Our peer facilitators are our students that work with other students, and they've received a lot of training, and we are very proud of that. Many schools do not have such a program. I won't list all of these, but I will say our mental health task force, led by Mr. Boggs, is a big part of that overall student assistance plan. Bowen has also provided significant additional services, training for us. The QPR is one of those, grief and loss training. We just had some outstanding autism training provided by them, and they're always ready to consult with us when we need them on a particular issue. What it also does is by having the student assistance plan, it puts us to the front of the line. So if we have a student that needs to get into Bowen, there can often be a 30 or 60 day wait. So this kind of puts us to the front of the line for staff as well. And we've referred staff as well. Ryan's Place is the piece that we want to add here, and what this is a grief and loss group. It's a non-for-profit that works out of Goshen, but they would come to the school and they put on a 10-week session with students at no cost to us, and they would repeat those sessions as needed. And this is for students that have suffered a loss, a parent, someone close to them. We've had 4 students lose a parent just this past summer, so then helping them process that, and that's just at the high school. So helping them deal with that, that can be very helpful. So that's our student assistance plan. Very good. We would ask that you acknowledge and let us meet with Ryan.
Would that take place during SRT or after school?
As needed.
Okay.
They may come out of class and meet.
So the 3 parents have declined. Do they know that they have at least 2 free sessions that they go to? They still decline?
People have different reasons for declining. but that's up to them.
Yeah, at least we try.
Great.
You know, I think if you talk to different educators, whether it's Tippecanoe Valley or any other school, they will tell you the number of mental health issues that kids today are dealing with is growing rapidly.
Okay.
So a program like this is just tremendously helpful. I mean, our counselors, we have two counselors at the high school. We have a counselor at Akron, one at Mentone, one at the middle school. We have a mental health therapist, and we still can't meet all those needs with those folks. So a program like this and the services they provide is just very, very helpful in helping our kids. And I think teachers will tell you until these needs are met, they're going to have a hard time dealing with the academics and being successful in the classroom.
I would add that really it's almost become uncommon to deal with a student that has a truly just an academic problem. Almost always that academic problem is tied into something else. So you can give all the tutoring in the world, but until that other stuff is dealt with, you're just spinning your wheels.
Thank you for your leadership, Dr.
Thank you.
Yeah,
your
leadership. Great. All right. Item four, presentation of the school approval.
Okay. Yes, each year the state of Indiana requires each of our schools to submit a school improvement plan. This year that plan is due to the state here December 1st, and so we've asked our principals to come in tonight and to share those with you. And first up is Mrs. Mills, Akron.
Is it okay?
He's already up. I think someone do that later.
Yeah, if you want to go ahead, he's first in the
queue. He's one of the leaders.
You butted in front of me in the other meeting.
Folks, this is the short version. It's a, I believe, a 77-page plan that you submitted to the state. I think that's about the average for all of us. So this is the abbreviated version of that. I'll just go through it quickly and certainly entertain any questions. We currently are using an end-of-course assessment to look at math and English proficiency. The last published scores were from the 14-15 school year, and those are our numbers there. We don't find those to be acceptable. We want those to be higher. Where we are is that we're at a transitional time. So ECA is being phased out. ISTEP is being phased back in for high school. So we're adjusting to that. We're trying to get the things that we need to do to score better in those areas. Graduation rate, we are very proud of this, that this continues to rise. This has been a focus for us. We very aggressively have gone after this. So we've shown a consistent rise the past 2 years, 3 years, and then I'm confident that it will go up again this year. So we 100%. So that's test scores are great, but we kids need to graduate. So that's what we're working at. Our letter grade remains a C. It had been declining. It stabilized at a C. Again, we are not satisfied with that. We want to be an A school. And we know how to do that. The state wants numbers. They want graduation rate. They want test scores. That's how they compute the letter grade. And we are providing those things. A few things we just highlighted on the bottom. And I would say that our goals then are kind of what we just mentioned, that we want to increase test scores, we want to increase graduation rate, we want to increase the school letter grade. That we want to be able to put an A on the side of that building, and I feel that we can do that. These are just some of the things that we highlighted on the bottom, things that we've done in the past few years. When we did our improvement plan, we got some high marks in technology and some lower marks. So we've addressed those things, and it's a continual needing to address those things. So next year we adopt a lot of new technology. We're working with teachers, students, parents on what that should look like, and reliability and quality of the technology is something we're looking at. We talked about the student assistance plan. The cattle is really a big thing for us, and I can't thank Mr. Kiley enough for taking point on that, but also Mr. Jones, Mr. Franklin, Mr. Schreiber. And really, that's a big deal for us. A lot of schools don't have that, and that is a significant thing for us. Our archery has doubled in size and continues to get bigger. Basic skills deal with some of our lower academic kids. Power standards and formative assessments, again, go back to the testing. School safety, communication. The big thing I wanted to focus on are additional college credit classes. So we're not just dealing at the lower level students. We've increased our ACP classes, which is dual credit through IU. Other dual credit classes, Project Lead the Way computer program with Mr. Parker, and he also has brought in certifications on top of the Project Lead the Way stuff. So a kid can graduate with a diploma and then also can graduate with numerous certifications, even without going out of college. So these are just some things that we've done at the high school. I've attached the executive summary, and then I know Mr. Boggs has the entire one.
Do you have any questions for Mr. Dr. Benson?
Dr. B, on these dual credit classes, is it getting any better? I knew there was some problems earlier when my older girls were in here with some colleges not accepting some of the credits. Is that getting any better, or where are we at there as far as, I mean, is there anything we can do, I guess, to...
We go out of our way to partner with colleges that are widely accepted.
Okay.
The ACP is through IU, and that's pretty much universally accepted throughout the state. Most of our dual credit classes are accepted at other colleges, but not all.
Okay.
So it depends on where you end up going. But it is more than just that college that we're partnering with. Okay. It's always more than just that college.
So if a child knows which college he or she wants to end up at, it's real important for her to know about these ACPs that they're doing, direct ones at that college or accepted. Yeah.
And they are accepted at many colleges.
Yeah.
The other issue, they can take that class and elect to not pay for the credit.
Yeah.
They would still take the class, and that would fulfill the graduation requirement anyway.
Right.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Mrs. Bills, now?
Sure.
Okay.
I didn't copy anything because it's a book.
Good. Say what you're in.
Just want to go over a few of the big things that Akron's looking at this year. One of the big items is Rainey and I are really trying to keep our buildings consistent so that we look like one. We are having a lot of move-ins, like back and forth between our buildings, so it's very good that we're on the same page. So if my child goes to his building or one of his children come to my building, we can, you know, it's very consistent, and we're really working hard to do that. So our plans are similar, but what I'm really working on at Akron is looking at our standards, making sure we're following our curriculum maps to a T, because everybody says schools teach to the test. Well, we need to be, because the test is the standards. And so, yes, we are teaching the standards so that our children do well on the test. Akron was a C school this past year, and no, we're not satisfied with that. We've been a C school for a couple years now. We altered, it was a pattern, A, C. It was going that route for a while, and now it's kind of leveled out to a C. With all the changes constantly in testing, you never know from year to year what's going to happen. So we're just teaching the Indiana standards like we need to be. We have great curriculum maps now that are very consistent from grade level. They're aligned. We're working on common assessments. And then also what's changed in here is K-2 is standard-based report card now at Mentone and Akron. Our teachers have worked very hard on those standard-based report cards so that when a parent sees that report card, they know exactly what the standards are that are being worked on, and they're parent-friendly.
They're not red like the state has them red. If you go on the DOE site, they're parent friendly, so that a parent understands, my child can count to 10, my child knows their uppercase letters. Very parent friendly, and that was the transition this year. So at parent-teacher conference, lots of discussion. I will say we had every child represented. I'll brag on my building for a minute. Every child represented at Akron except for three. That's how high our parent-teacher conference turnout was this year. So we were able to discuss those report cards and really get that communication out. So that was two goals for us, is making sure we're teaching those standards and looking at our curriculum and then pushing those standard-based report cards. So those are the big pushes this year at Akron. As in parent feedback, when we did this back in May was the survey. The biggest thing that was an issue was the facility being up to date. Well, we're working on that too. So next school year, our facility will definitely be up to date and one of the top, I think, in the community. So definitely. Any questions? Thanks.
Normally we have Mr. Dodge present Benton's plan. I got a text from him a little bit ago that he is not going to be able to join us tonight. So if you have any questions about Benton's plan, let me know. I'll get those to him and get answers back to you.
Where's that grade at, Brad?
Chrissy, where was Benton last year?
C?
Oh, that is the same.
I think it was the same, or was it a B? No, we kept it the same last year.
Okay.
We went by the year before. That's right. Is that the year?
Last year was the whole car last year.
Yeah. Was the what?
The whole car last year. Last year.
I think he's either a B or a C.
Yeah.
Pretty
close.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I didn't bring a handout either because my 75-page document also has a 25-page addendum on it for the DOE. So because the middle school's been in focus and priority status over the last couple years, I'm going to actually focus on what we're doing with our student achievement plan, which is what I work with the DOE directly on for our school growth. I actually attend a monthly meeting with a principal's group with other schools that are in our situation. We talk about things we're doing, things we're trying to improve and benefit for our kids. Our goals focus on growth and proficiency. We need our kids to grow more. We need our kids to be more proficient. You know, I've talked to the board in the past about our special ed numbers, about a lot of the different hurdles we have, and we know that's not an excuse. We want to be able to get our scores into that 80-90% range to be pulled in the ARB as a school. One of the things that we had as some negative feedback on our parent survey last year was lack of technology. So it's nice to know that at this point we've addressed the single biggest concern that the parents had about our school building with the one-to-one initiative. We've been able to provide a sufficient amount of technology to be able to help teachers in the classroom teach more effectively and to give kids some 21st century skills. We're using that one-to-one technology to work on power standards as well. This is year three for me in the middle school. Year one, we spent the year building our curriculum maps as teachers based on the Indiana State standards. Last year, we focused in our collaboration PLC process on developing solid lesson planning. This year, we're working on developing critical assessments, formative assessments, and developing data that's going to help us drive improvement in our classrooms and make adjustments when kids aren't getting things. So, kind of in year three of the plan to continue to work on this process. Stacy Revere, our academic coach, has been fantastic. She's working with my core academics, so math, language arts, science, and social studies right now, professional development sessions where they're going into the standards, pulling out the power standards, mapping the critical pieces we need to be teaching the kids. Data for us. Last year we had our highest number of kids in advanced and proficient on SRI, which is a reading index. So over the last 10 years, of data last year. It's the highest we've seen the reading levels in our building be. So we know that the reading programs we have in place, we know that the work the elementary is doing is feeding in. We've got kids coming in reading better. The other piece of data that Mr. Boggs actually has right there, interestingly enough, last year, the state took our 14-15 data, which on their previous scoring scale showed us to be an F school, and they put the exact same data with the exact same kids on their new scoring form, were C. Same kids, same data, same information, two different ways the state's looking at it. Is a two-letter grade difference for the same kids and the same scores. So it's frustrating right now because we have a high needs group. We're working hard to meet the needs of those kids, but the target's moving constantly. And, you know, the other principals talked about they've shifted the test. They've changed what they're going to do. You know, we've got a memo out that ISTEP's going away after this year. We've got another memo not long ago that says, but we may have to do it one more year because of funding. So the state doesn't even really know where we're at. It's all over the place. And again, being in a school where we're trying to work to improve these things is very frustrating when that target's moving all over the place. But we know we have to do a better job with instruction in our classrooms. And so that's been our focus, is working on better teaching, working on using data to be better to judge where kids are and what they need. We're doing that through the PLC training process. We now have, I believe, 9 staff members in the middle school who've gone through the Summer Institute for PLC. Those people are being very good leaders in our building, helping us move forward and make some critical decisions about what we're doing in the classroom. We've increased communication in the last year at the middle school drastically. Our web page is updated. We have SDI Chalkable, which parents can access to see kids' grades. Kids can access their grades on a daily basis. We're using the text message service from 911 for athletics, where a coach can simply put a message in, hit the send button. It goes to all the students who are participating in that athletic team. We're using Facebook and Twitter. Parent-teacher conferences that we just ran, we had our highest total since I've been in the building, with 94% of our parents at the middle school level getting a parent-teacher conference. Not quite to the almost 100% accuracy, but for us, we've changed the format. I know some of you who've had kids go through in the past, we would sit around the cafeteria and you'd go table to table, talk to the teachers you wanted to talk to. We were in the 30 to 40% range in attendance in that format. Now, having our homeroom teachers contact parents directly, invite them in to a student-led conference. We've been, over the last 5 years running this program, we've been in that high 80%, low 90% range every time, getting parents in the door. So communication's much better. This power of ICU software we talked about, that's auto-texting and auto-messaging parents when kids are put on a missing assignment list, has been critical. And so we do a really fantastic job in middle school communication. If you don't know what's going on at the middle school, you're doing a good job of not looking at what we're putting out. So just a couple other highlights of things we're doing a little different this year. We're adding life skills curriculum that will start here third quarter, which is our family consumer science and our PE health departments working together to do a mental health, social skills program with our 7th and 8th graders, and so that was board approved, I believe, at the end of last spring, but it's going to be a program to kind of tie in with a little bit of what they're doing with the student assistance program at the high school, but it's going to be teaching all the kids some basic coping skills, functioning in life skills. For those of you that haven't been over to the middle school for a while, the area that was the wood shop has now been completely renovated. And all of the weight room equipment that was at Tipton Valley High School starting in 75, a few of the updates since then, has been refinished by Hoffman Body Shop and is now set up in our cage area for our PE classes. And they're going down right now, I believe it's 2 days a week, and the kids are doing some low weight, high rep weight room workouts as a part of PE and conditioning. We're in year 2 Project Leadway at the middle school. Our 8th graders are getting ready right now to design and program with robots. So that'll be coming up here before Christmas break. They'll be doing some programming work with those. We have the Purdue STEM Science Labs now in all three grade levels, where Purdue provides us with STEM equipment that we use with our science curriculum, lab-based. And then this year we have new math curriculum, and every kid has an Alex license, which is math remediation. So every kid in our building is doing math remediation work or math acceleration work on top of what they're doing in the general math class because they have devices to use. So there's a lot of really great things we're working on. Obviously, our bottom line is that we want to see the results be better for us on ISTEP, and we know we're not where we want to be, and that's why we're doing all these things to try to address those issues. So, any questions?
No. No. Thanks, Scott. Item 5, the 2017-2018 Master School Calendar.
Yes, we have in front of you a recommended calendar for the 17-18 school year. I'd like to take a little time to just go through some of the features of that. It contains 180 student days, 185 teacher days. Teacher orientation day would be Thursday, August the 3rd. There are two staff development days. One of those is, it would be Friday, August 4th. The other one would be Wednesday, January the 3rd. The first student day would be Monday, August the 7th. That's a corresponding date to this year. Fall break would be Monday, the 16th of October. We would have a three-day Thanksgiving break, which we have this year as well. 11-day Christmas break for students, 10 days for staff. There would be no school on Good Friday. If there are no delay days or cancellation days, excuse me, we finish on May the 17th with graduation on June the 3rd. There are 10 emergency makeup days prior to graduation. We probably, the last few years, have averaged 5 to 6 days a year. So hopefully we would not have to use all 10 of those. We'd have 91 student days in the first semester, 89 student days in the second semester. This calendar is nearly identical to this year's calendar. And we have had a lot of positive feedback from a number of different people that like this year's calendar. We discussed this with the Teachers Association earlier this month. They liked it. They said take it to the board, so we'll bring it to you tonight for initial discussion. We'll bring it back to you next month then for approval, so that those who are trying to plan vacations and plan ahead will have the calendar and they can do that. In fact, I had a staff member come over today and asked me if I knew when fall break was going to be next year. I said, well, not yet, but we're getting close. So, what questions do you have about, about the calendar?
No, I like the one this year. Seems a little more junior.
Get any comments or questions, let me know, and I'll bring this back to you next month.
Okay. Any other new business?
That's it.
No. Student representative, what's happening at the high school?
All right.
I know you've been waiting all night to tell us.
Yeah. In October, we had the school board forum, the political and economic studies class of the high school. Put that together with some help of Jeff Shriver and Jim Hazel. We had a pretty good turnout. Quite a few people came, talked to as many people as I could afterwards, and a lot of positive feedback on that. I think our biggest issue there was getting the coffee maker to work. So, I mean, that's a good thing. We had Thanksgiving coming up. We just did our club switch. These clubs are great for our students to really get involved and look at different interests. I mean, I'm in a club right now where we're making concrete countertops. So you make them shine just like granite. It's not granite, but it looks pretty. The School of Rock Club in particular is producing some songs. And so they have their band together, and they're looking at making some songs and possibly even an album. The Student Council Leadership Conference, that was the state convention, They're a really good group of individuals there. They missed a speaker to walk 5 miles round trip to see Kate Jones. And I'm sure all of you are aware of Kate Jones' story, but I mean, that just shows the kind of character that our students have. We hope for a strong finish for the semester. It's been taking a lot of hard work. Our peers group has been able to do a lot of really cool things, and I'll let Cheyenne touch on that with what we were able to do there. The college credit classes, like Dr. Bendixson touched on, really great opportunity. I'm glad to be in the ACP class. Hardest class I've ever taken, but it has taught me so much about writing a paper that I never thought I could get to this level of writing, and I thought I was a good writer. I was terrible. So I'm going to turn this over to Cheyenne. She's going to tell you some more things.
Okay, recently, I believe it was last Monday, wasn't it? I went to Bowen Center in Warsaw, and we attended a youth mental health first aid training program, I guess. And it was a 9-hour program. We left at 7 in the morning, I believe. And we were trained to detect warning signs and respond to warning signs of a variety of mental illnesses that students and anyone really has. And this was pretty cool because it potentially allows us to get students the help they need. And it really made us aware of the amount and the extent of these illnesses that people have. Also, student council. We've been doing things for Thanksgiving for five different families, and we're providing meals for 5 different families that can't afford it for themselves. And each student brings in a different food item, such as a turkey or green beans or anything like that. So it's pretty cool to see our students there in the community.
Very good.
Well,
that's what we got going on.
Yes, it is. Good. And now you're getting all ready for the fall dinner programs, right? Sports?
Yes.
Good job. Anything else? Okay, nothing else. This meeting is adjourned.